Well, hello, hello, hello. Welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dann Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for listening. Listening with your ears and with your mind and with all the other parts of you that listen. Thank you. Thank you for being here at 25 O'Clock. Oh, on the show this week, taking a bit of a break from sort of the more music-oriented stuff that I talk about here on this show. That's obviously a huge part of 25 O'Clock, and that's obviously a huge part of me, to talk about music, either music here from Philadelphia or music from beyond. But I have other things. I know other people, man. You don't know me, man. Maybe you do. Anyway, on the program this week, not a musician, but an awesome, awesome human being who's done tons and tons of stuff. Her name is Melissa Eckstrom. She is currently a Peace Corps volunteer down in Jamaica. I've known her for a little bit, and she had a very brief window back in this country for a couple of days, and I had to get her to come down into the 25 O'Clock basement lair and talk about everything she does, not just the stuff she does in Jamaica right now, but the stuff she's done before when she was part of AmeriCorps out in the Midwest and where she came from and, you know, what motivates a person to, you know, sort of cast off any idea of a normal life and go be a Peace Corps volunteer. So we have a great, great chat about that, and I'm really excited about it. I had a wonderful talk with her. She's a very very cool, very open, very giving person. And I hope you all appreciate that too. Oh, but before we get there, go to 25oclockpod.com. That's the online headquarters, the online lair, the online secret base. It's not so secret. I just told you how to get there. Of 25 O'Clock, 25oclockpod.com. You can check out the old episodes in the archive. You can click on links to any of the guests or people who have ever had anything to do with this show. Everything you need for 25 O'Clock is there at 25oclockpod.com. Ooh, okay, so we're putting the episode out a little early this week, and I want to do that for a couple of reasons. Number one, I'm taking off pretty soon. Gotta go, gotta head up home and do the Thanksgiving holiday thing, and I'm sure a lot of you are getting ready to do that as well. So I also wanted to put it out early so maybe you would have something to listen to in the car, on the headphones, if you're on the bus, on the plane, on the train, on the boat. I don't know. I don't know how you're getting where you're going. If it is a boat, that is incredibly cool, and you should tell me more about that, where you need to go, that you need to be on a boat. But anyway, that's why the episode's coming out a little early this week, and Thanksgiving is upon us. A lot of people are heading home. A lot of people are heading to see family, sometimes people that we don't see very often. Maybe this is one of the only times in a year that you see certain members of your family, and that could be great. That could be exactly the way you want it, or it could be sad and you wish you could see them more. Anyway, I'm not going to wax maudlin or sentimental about that in particular, but with a guest like Melissa Eckstrom being on the show this week, I thought that it was important to point out that we're all going to head home and we're all going to see people and be with people. Maybe it's people we saw last week, maybe it's people we saw a month ago or 6 months ago or a year ago, but there are people out there who are doing service, who are living extraordinary lives, living non-ordinary lives outside of the norm, and aren't really able to go home. And this is not a sob story. This is not like a boo-hoo, feel sad for these people, because these people have chosen their lives. People like Melissa and her fellow Peace Corps volunteers have chosen their lives in the Peace Corps. People out there in the military have chosen their lives to be in the military. People like my uncle who are out there in the middle of the woods, keeping an eye on dams and hydroelectric plants, you know, things like that. And they don't always get to be with their families on the holidays. So take a moment in your holiday festivities, in your eating and drinking and, God, hopefully not too much fighting, to think about people who, like I said, who have chosen the extraordinary lives that they have, but, you know, maybe don't get to be home in the same way that you get to be home. So we'll all think about them this holiday season. That's enough. Like I said, I wasn't going to wax all sentimental on that. I just wanted to bring facts to light that there are people who are not going to be home for Thanksgiving for various reasons. Anyway, We're going to get on to my conversation with Melissa Eckstrom in just 1 second. You can check out her blog. She's really, really been chronicling her journey, not just in Jamaica, but before that as well. So if you like what you hear on the show and you want to know more about Melissa, it's all there on her blog, mxdrum.wordpress.com. That's the letter M, the letter X, drum, like boom, boom, boom. drum.wordpress.com. And of course, I'm going to put that link up at 25oclockpod.com as well. So yeah, let's just get right to it. Let's get to my conversation with Melissa Eckstrom right here on 25 O'Clock. But not too much.
Must be nice to have your space, though.
I mean, it's fantastic. How did your thing go on at the library?
It went really well. So there were some technical difficulties. I prepared a presentation with a lot of my art, and I kind of knew which jokes I was going to do and everything. Because
there were jokes.
Yeah, I like to involve humor with pretty much anything because, well, self-humiliation is really the way I go. So,
is the Peace Corps full of self-humiliation?
Yes. For example, if you really want the locals to like you, you just have to dance. And, I mean, for me, that's self-humiliation.
Poorly, well, it doesn't matter.
It does not matter. They just love to see you dancing, especially in Jamaica. So, there's technical difficulties, but, you know, I'm a Peace Corps volunteer, so you have to be flexible, and I made it work.
You have to be ready for nothing to work at
yes.
all.
But it was really great, because there's about three people who came up to me after who were in the application process. So I was
cool.
Well, this was helpful for some people, and, you know, I was able to answer their questions.
How does something like that get set up? Did someone just ask you to do it, or did, like, the Peace Corps set it up, or?
Okay, so the backstory is really, if you do a recruitment event, you earn a vacation day back. So to me, it's an hour of my time. Doesn't take much to set up. You link up with the Peace Corps recruiter in your area. Super easy. So it was great for me. And it was at the library near Rittenhouse Square. Mm-hmm. So it was really nice space. And, you know, bang, vacation day earned.
That's interesting. And I definitely want to talk more about just the ins and outs of how the Peace Corps works. I mean, we all know how it works as a larger entity, or some of us do, but how it works, like, on a day-to-day of just, like, being linked up with them and, like, how you now navigate the world and, like, because it's a job. It's not just, you're not on vacation. Like, you're doing work.
Right.
But we'll get there. But I want to take it back because you grew up here. You're from Philly, right?
I am from Philly.
Like, where did you grow up? What neighborhood did you grow up in?
I grew up in Northeast Philly. I actually first grew up in Longcrest and then spent most of my life in Lower Mayfair.
Okay.
And then in my adult years, I've lived in Fishtown. I live in South Philly. Not so far from here, actually.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Lower Mayfair is, that's almost suburbs, too, when I think about it hard enough.
It's kind of like 10 minutes from Frankfurt Terminal, so yeah. I wouldn't call it suburbs, but yeah. it's a just family neighborhood.
Yeah, yeah. I have friends who live up there, too, and the first time I went to their house, I'm just like, you have a driveway and a front yard. What is going on here? So you grew up, are you only, or do you have brothers, sisters?
I have a brother, half-brother, stepbrother, and stepsister. And her name is actually Melissa, too. So, and we shared a room, so it was kind of like Melissa's room.
Are they just so obviously?
Two divorced families come together.
Yeah.
Like Brady Bunch.
Like Brady Bunch. Were they divorced on the Brady Bunch, or was someone dead? I never really.
You know what? I don't know.
I never got, because, like,
did I say that in the theme song?
No, it's not in the song, but you think it would come up at some point. I think so. I think people were dead. I think that was how you did stuff on TV back then. Like, you couldn't just be divorced. We couldn't have divorced people having fun.
Something tragic had to have happened.
Something, yeah. Like,
love doesn't just fail.
Just like on Full House. Like, you know, the mom's dead, and that's hammered into you once a season. Oh, by the way, remember, the kid's mom's dead.
Oh, man.
So it just happened to be. And I've never thought about that. But yeah, if two people come together who already have children and form a larger family, if by luck of the draw, like, two of them happen, oh yeah, we happen to both name our daughters the same thing. And yep. You're looking, you're just like, well, do we rename? Do we
rename?
You put them in a room together and it'd be like, all right, whoever comes out gets to keep the name. That's all. So you grew up in, like, a big-ish biggest household?
I grew up in a row home.
Yeah.
And it was a three bedroom. It's pretty tight. And, you know, my mom's actually the sort of person who, while we grew up, she kind of brought in all, like, the misfit children, too. So we always had, like, a friend, like, who got kicked out of the house living with us. She's just, I think my mom was a wild child growing up herself. So somehow, you know, like, I had a friend live with me. My brother had, like, multiple friends live with us as we grew up. So It was always a very full house, but it was, you know, I think it made, like, the whole roommate thing in my adult life very easy. College was very easy, you know. I'm used to being around a lot of people.
Yeah. So, I mean, that actually kind of answers something that I was going to ask you. The idea of just, like, it sounds like you grew up in a pretty progressive household, just in terms of, you know, of opening up your home to, you know, non-family. And now you're in this kind of lifestyle that's all service-focused, all kind of volunteerism sort of type thing. Was that kind of thing, like, was that in the house growing up? Like, did you guys, like, I don't know how to add, it was like, you know, service and volunteerism and, like, you know, community outreach and stuff like that kind of, like, part of growing up? Or
yeah, that's funny. Actually, I would say no. I don't know where it actually came from. It's just when I was in my teenage years, I felt unsatisfied. Like, I needed to do more and more and more, and helping people out just felt good, so it kind of, I kept doing that.
What did you do, like, when you were a teenager? Like, what kind of stuff did you get involved in then?
Let's see. When I was a teenager, I was really into, like, random act of kindness. Like, you know, I like to, like, leave little notes in, like, library books, like, with motivational messages and just, like, find ways to make people smile. So it wasn't like I was going out and, like, volunteering at a church or anything. But just I enjoyed making people laugh and smile. Mm-hmm. So finding little ways to do that.
And you were big into art and music too, I know, when you were younger.
Yes, for sure.
Because you still draw now. Was drawing always, like, part of being you growing up?
Yes, I definitely drew my entire life. My dad bought me my first sketchbook, and then I just never stopped from there. I was really obsessed with, like, Dragon Ball Z and Sailor Moon over the years, so kind of copying those drawings is how I really got into it. And that's actually how I got into comics and cartooning, which is my favorite medium.
Yeah, because when I first met you were drawing tiny comics on literally everything. And then music too. Were you, because I know you play uke, but that was a later thing that came into your life, right?
Yeah, I did pick up a guitar when I was 14 or, like, around that age, and, you know, I just thought, like, I was kind of lame, you know. I was like, Kurt Cobain's so great, I'm gonna play guitar, you know. I was in that phase. And then kind of never really kept up with it. Then around 16, 17, I started listening to a lot of singer-songwriters and, like, Jeffrey Lewis and, like, Kimmy Dawson. I was really inspired by them because I felt like it was very raw.
Well, especially Kimmy Dawson, like Moldy Peaches and stuff like that.
Right.
They were freaks, and they weren't the regular sort of, like, you know, good-looking, like, Gap-type singer-songwriter where, like, everything was already put together. Like, they were regular looking people, and they sang about really weird shit.
Yeah, so I was kind of, like, scared to do music, I guess, but when I saw them doing it, and, like, even, like, Daniel Johnson, he just does his own thing, and I just felt like I could do it, you know. I don't have to be at this certain point before I share my music, so
it doesn't have to be completely polished. It doesn't have to sound like a finished record when you get down. You're like, these people sound pretty raw, but it's more about what they're saying than necessarily how it's recorded or how it's presented.
Right, because I feel like art for me is very easy, but when it comes to music, it's not something that's, like, second nature. Mm-hmm. I feel like it's something I'm not very confident in doing, so I guess it comes back to that. It's just like, well, they're doing it, so.
Yeah. Well, no, but that's good. I think a lot of art needs to be challenging. If you did the same thing that was just simple and easy all the time, then it wouldn't be fulfilling. It would be like going to work.
Right. Yeah. And I mean, over the years, my partner, George, he's a really great musician. So playing with him has been really great because he can explain music theory to me, which, you know, I'm starting to wrap my head around. And
see, one of those guys, when he explains things, you kind of nod, because I'm the same way. I nod. I'm like, okay, that's great. All right, I don't care. Like, I'm just gonna do the thing that sounds good right there.
Yeah.
And I picked it up enough over years where I can sit down. If I have to sit down and figure it out, I will. But, like, when someone's just like, well, no, you've got a B right there, and if you play a G over that, I'm like, I don't. like, just tell me when it sounds good. And,
right,
and we're
right.
good. Like I don't need rules, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're a teenager, you're kicking around Northeast Philly, and you're leaving notes in library books and drawing things on things probably for people to see and stuff like that.
Yeah, I used to, on the L train, there'd be the, and I actually just did this today. It's kind of like to, I don't know, I just wanted to re-experience it, I guess. But when the advertisements are up, it'll be like some like awful lawyer advertisement or something. I always flip it around, and like I always have a Sharpie on me, and I just draw whatever message I want to be on there and whatever I want to advertise, and then just put that up. And I'm sure like a worker takes it down almost immediately. But
so you take the ad and just turn it around?
Yeah, and I just doodle on it.
You're like, let's make something that's not this lawyer.
Yeah, yeah. And if you know, it gives me something to do during the ride. I just get to draw. Yeah. And before you know it, you're getting off and you have your little art up.
Yeah, yeah. And it's the city, so no one's going to stop you. Like, no one's going to come up to you and be like, she shouldn't be doing that.
Right. I don't think anyone even really notices. Maybe when I'm putting it back in, they're like,
what is
huh?
she doing with that?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's funny. Well, now people keep an eye out there if you see. Well, it's probably gone by now. No, other people should take up arms to do that. Like, turn the personal injury lawyer signs around, draw on them. But don't turn around the ones for things that help, like food stamps or medical
public
insurance.
Public safety.
Yeah, I do love, I mean, you haven't been back in a while, but did you notice the new SEPTA campaign, the Dude, It's Rude campaign?
No.
Oh, it's great. It's great. It's all the stuff that used to piss you off about like being on the subway. Like, this is a big sentence. It's like, dude, two seats, come on, man. And then like, the campaign is like, dude, it's rude. It's like, dude, this ain't a restaurant. Come on, man. And it's like, no eating on the train or something like that.
So I wonder what would happen if you actually did come up to someone from Philly and say, like, dude, that's rude.
Oh, you get your ass kicked. Like, absolutely. Hands down, that is what would happen. I got a kick out of it, though, because I'm like, yeah, those are all the things. Yeah, like, people eating, like, full Chinese meals, people sprawled out across two or three seats, and there was one of my headphones, too. It's just like, I don't need to hear your awful music played through tinny phone speakers from the other side of the car. Like, I don't need any of that.
Right. But I have to say it's quite spacious because living in Jamaica now, mm-hmm. taking the public taxis, you have to small up, which means crunch your body as small as possible so at least four people can sit in the back seat.
Of a car?
Yes.
Does the taxi just like pick other people up while it's taking you to a place? It is not your private.
Exactly. Okay. It's called a route taxi.
Oh, okay. So it's like a tiny bus, a tiny car sized bus.
Yeah. So people are hopping in and out as you go along.
Jumping on the sides of it.
Yes. And you know, yes, and, like, if someone's opening the door, you say small up. So that just means squish as far as you can. And you know, you kind of hope you're squished enough that because there's no seatbelts that you just won't like fly out.
Nothing will happen. That this simple physics and force will just hold everyone into one place.
Yeah. Yes.
So when you finished high school, I know you were in AmeriCorps at some point.
Yeah. So
that was like the first big sort of service step that you took.
Exactly. When I finished high school, I moved to Vermont for a year, and that was just like, I wanted to go to art school, but financially it wasn't really working out. So I was just like, whatever, just gonna move to Vermont. So moved up to Burlington, Vermont. You know, I was just working and going to the community college, trying to figure out my life. And after it was 2012, actually, that I kind of was at the point where I wasn't sure where I wanted to go to school. So I took a break and joined AmeriCorps NCCC. That stands for National Civilian Community Corps.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a 10-month program. There's five campuses around the U.S. I was based in Vinton, Iowa. You don't get to choose. So, you know, I get this letter like, you have 10 days to accept or decline, you know, this AmeriCorps position in Vinton, Iowa. I'm like, I don't know it. Anything about corn. Okay.
Yeah.
But I did it, and I was actually working at the same location as you at the time, so
yeah.
I knew I was like going for a big change. I loved that job, but I felt like ready for something new.
Yeah. You can't. If you had stayed there, I would have yelled at you.
Yeah, so I headed out, and it was definitely one of the best things that I've ever done. I was just exposed to so much.
When did you get the itch to do that? I mean, like you said you were always into just kind of doing little things for people growing up, but like where did like that kind of self-motivation come into not just like wander around and draw your comics and put your notes and just be nice to people, to be like, oh, I'm going to eschew any idea of profitable career and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, I'm going to go to the middle of Iowa and do this thing that I have no idea what it is.
Right. I think I've just always, I can't seem to fall into the flow of like, just like work and school or just like, I, at least in that stage of my life, I just wasn't satisfied. I was just like looking for something new, and I love to travel and I love adventure, and it just made sense. And if I didn't like it, I didn't like it, but I just had to hop out and try it out.
Yeah. Well, it seems like you did like it.
Oh, yes.
What did you do, like, briefly, like, kind of walk me through, like, what's a 10-month stint with AmeriCorps? What's the difference between AmeriCorps and Peace Corps? Are they kind of under the same umbrella? I know one is obviously in this country, and then one is international.
Right.
Are they under the same umbrella, or are they two completely different things?
No, they're both federally funded, but when you want to like give the lazy answer of AmeriCorps, you'll say like it's domestic Peace Corps, but you know it's actually very different. Peace Corps is 2 years. AmeriCorps can, there is actually an umbrella of AmeriCorps, so there's state and national, and that's when there's like an outside organization, like maybe like Habitat for Humanity, and you're assigned to them. And then there's VISTA, AmeriCorps VISTA, which is living kind of by yourself in a community doing some sort of it could be anything. It's all very vague because...
Well, they don't know what it is until they get the bodies. And they're like, all right, we'll send these people here and send these people there to work on that project and these people to work on that project.
Right. But the program that I did, NCCC, is team-based. So you're placed on a team and you travel around with that team and do 2-month projects throughout the region that you're assigned to. So I was in the Midwest. So during that time, I got to see 4 different states and... I did many different things. I was on the fire team, so
fire. What is the? do you cause the fires or do you eliminate the fire? What?
I was doing wildland firefighting, so we were doing prairie restoration, and that was
that's true. And you do, there's controlled burn involved
exactly.
In that. Yeah, yeah.
And that was so fun.
My uncle works for just fought a bunch of the forest fires with obviously other more professional people up in the Skagit River up in near Seattle when they had the fires.
Right. Yeah, it was crazy. I mean, I was following it. And also, my partner is a wildland firefighter. So I'm always following it. He just got back from Idaho. So,
It is the season.
Yeah. And honestly, I love it. I'm thinking about after Peace Corps, I'll just hop right into that and do some wildland firefighting and like make a lot of money. It's long hours and hard work and, you know, dangerous, but you make a lot of money in a short amount of time.
Yeah. What do they call them? The guys who are in there, like smoke jumpers or something like that.
Oh, yeah. The smoke jumpers.
Well, those are the guys who like literally jump out of the plane.
Right.
Literally into the fire and look around and be like, yep, it's a fire.
Yeah. Or like, you know, sometimes you have to get your gear, like, or even yourself in on a helicopter and you're just like, oh, this is cool.
So, fire team. What else did you do besides fire?
Okay. I worked with Habitat for Humanity, actually, and we did a blitz build. So, we were helping set up for and then actually doing a 10-house build for a house, for a neighborhood that was kind of torn apart by a hurricane. So, that was really fun because we got to work with the families that were actually going to move into these houses. And that was really special. I worked at a summer camp in Minnesota, and...
When you said Minnesota right there, you sounded like you're from Minnesota.
Man, I don't even know what my accent is anymore between being from Philly and in Jamaica. Just...
And then living in the Midwest.
Yeah,
and,
everything.
You know, oh, wow.
Everything.
Oh, wow. And then you were in New England, and then you spent time in New England, so you got that going for you, too.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes people ask me, like, where are you from?
It's like, I have no idea.
But sometimes it's very obvious I'm from Philly, you know. Like,
when you start shouting at someone, like, for minor infractions,
yes, you're
from Philly.
But yeah, for Willow River, I was working at a summer camp, so that was fun. I never worked at a summer camp before. And it was called One Heartland, and we helped run a camp for like gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender youth.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and that was so much fun. These were kids who never had really the freedom to express themselves in the way that, you know, they were able to run around the camp and wear dresses and
be themselves.
Be themselves, exactly.
And find other people like them, too, because I imagine in the middle of the country, too, you probably don't find too many other people who are going to outwardly identify themselves to you as being like you if you're gay or lesbian or
have things like this. So it must have been a blast for them to just be like, you're like me. This is great. We don't have to hide and pretend that we're this other way.
Right. And I mean, it was so much fun to just see them having a good time.
Oh, wow.
So I had one last project, and that was working on a wildlife refuge with U.S. Fish and Wildlife. That was in North Dakota. Very isolated. We didn't see many people during that time. Yeah. But we were also doing a little bit of burning prairie restoration during that time, but it was kind of slowing down. So we did a lot of taking down barbed wire fence. So had a lot of holes in my clothes during that period.
Oh, gosh. And then from there, you went to college in Vermont, to Sterling College, which I looked up a bit over the last couple of days. It's a fascinating institution. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, you probably tell better than I will, but like you did like this program of like farm sustainability, and there's also like a community aspect to it too, like this thing that is totally in the now right now. Like it's something that like every college should probably have a program like this.
It was a really special experience. Just as a side note, before AmeriCorps and finishing AmeriCorps and going to Sterling College, I did a long distance bicycle trip. If you want to keep on the timeline.
Okay. we can jump in and out. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, this is all on your blog. So if anyone does want to keep on the timeline with Melissa, she has a very well-kept blog, which is saying something. So many people's blogs, they start things, don't finish them, things like that. But you've kept going. Like I was jumping back through pages. You have 16, 17 whole pages on there of links going all the way back to like you like going to AmeriCorps for the first time or something like that. It was really something.
Yeah, it's been about 5 years now, so it's been nice. But as far as Sterling College, I found out about it before AmeriCorps, but then I got accepted into the program. So I went into AmeriCorps knowing I was going to the school after, so I was very excited to transfer in. And it's really crazy school. I mean, people ask, like, where do you go to school? It's a school they never heard of, and like they start to find out more, and I'm just like, yeah, I go to school with like 100 other people. Yeah. My graduating class was like 9 people.
Well, what did you focus on there?
I studied sustainable agriculture, and it's also a work college, as you probably research. Yeah. So there's 7 work colleges in the U.S. right now. So everyone on campus has a job. And that helps pay off your tuition.
Oh, interesting.
And the whole time, pretty much the whole time, I worked on the garden crew. So you have people working in the garden because we grow our own food. You have people working in the kitchen because we prepare our own meals. There's people working with the livestock. There's people helping do some more community projects like the nursing homes in the area.
Oh, okay.
So it's very, very community focused. So I think it's kind of what I was looking for, I think, this whole time.
So you're not even really in a class. You're not spending much time in a classroom at all in this. I mean, obviously they're teaching you a few things, like some fundamentals, but it sounds like most of your time is spent doing rather than listening.
Oh, you're definitely in a classroom, but there's a great balance of lecture and then hands-on experience. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Like sometimes your classroom may be like in a canoe, like studying
in a canoe
watershed, you know, organisms in the water.
Yeah.
So it's very, you know, touch, feel, like see, observe, you know.
Well, it's more in the style of a traditional vocational education as opposed to the more academic education. Well, at least in vocational education, it's almost entirely hands-on. Like we're teaching you how to do a thing, how to manipulate a thing, fix a thing, make a thing, take a thing apart, etc. You said there are 7 others that are like it. Are they all kind of within a network of like-minded institutions, or they're just 7 other colleges that are like that?
I'd say the college that's most like our school is Warren Wilson. I don't know if you're familiar with that school.
I don't know. No, I'm not.
It's in North Carolina, and it has a much larger body. You know, I said we're about definitely at this point still less than 150 students because the population has grown. Warren Wilson, I think, has about 2,000.
Oh, wow.
But the rest of the schools are actually more on the conservative side. They're like in Missouri, Kentucky. Where are the other ones? But it's funny because depending on where you are, since it's a work study college, the jobs will reflect that because, like, I know one of the schools, the jobs may be something like daycare because, like, a lot of the students have kids.
Oh, okay.
So it's just very different, you know?
Oh, so, like, so if you're in one part of the country, it reflects more of...
Yeah, because
the sort of makeup and social and economic climate of that particular place, because in Vermont would be definitely one kind of thing, and then North Carolina would be different than, you say, Kentucky, which is different from that as well. So
right, because, you know, a work colleague shouldn't really be any whatever jobs the school needs done, that's what the students are going to do.
Okay. And then how are you there for, like, what, a year, 2 years, something like that?
2 years, yeah. Okay.
Did you get, like, a bachelor? Like, is that, like, a, like an, I mean, obviously it's an accredited university, but you get, like, a, you have, like, a bachelor's of sciences or a bachelor's of...
Yeah, because I did 2 years of community college. One, you know, I never really, I didn't want to jump into a university because I wasn't really sure of what I wanted to do. So I was just kind of taking classes of things I was interested in.
Yeah.
Growing up. And then when I found the school, and I was just like, I want to go here, you know. It's actually in this neighborhood that we're in right now, South Philadelphia, that I had my first garden, like urban garden. And I just kind of, it blew up from there. I didn't want to do anything else but grow food. You could always vermicompost, you know.
I have thought about composting because my back home up in upstate New York, my mom does it, my brother does it, all the people up there do it. I know that it can smell really bad sometimes, and it, and as you know, in South Philly, it's very, very close to the house.
Right, but if you vermicompost, which
What's
is
that?
It's composting of red wigglers, which is a certain species of earthworms.
Yeah.
So basically, you put them in a bin, and they are consuming your food waste.
Oh, interesting.
Rapidly, so there really isn't much of a smell.
You just put them in earth, and then just put your stuff on top of it.
Yeah, you kind of make like, you know, there's a whole way to do it, but you just kind of make a lasagna of kind of a bottom you could put on cardboard to kind of retain the moisture, put a little bit of soil, put your food scraps, and then you just add them in. I'm sure there's so many people vermicomposting these days that if you put a handful of those worms in, they'll reproduce so fast that you'll have a whole system going before you know it. But they're eating the food scraps, they're pooping, great for the soil, they're dying, breaking down, great for the soil, and then when you add that, your plants will be happy, trust me.
So you just do this right in the box with the plants, or?
No, you would have a separate like bucket or bin. Like a 5-gallon bucket, it's perfect to start, or a tote bin.
Yeah.
They crawl up to eat, so it's a tote bin's better because they have more surface area to eat.
And then what do you do with the soil that they just, you just use that soil in with your other soil?
Yeah, so eventually what you would do is kind of get another tote bin and like restart the whole bin. But before you put them back in, you kind of like you extract the soil, but put it through a like netted thing that will catch them. So you're saving the worms and you have this really, really nice, rich soil. It's definitely worth it.
And you don't have to buy it.
And it takes zero of your, it takes no time besides throwing in your food scraps,
vegetable scraps and things like
that. Right, right. Yeah.
Okay.
I recommend it.
All right. You heard it here. I hope everyone was taking notes. It's a podcast, so you can go back like a couple minutes right there and listen to what she said again and write it down. Because I didn't.
The worms idea, are cool.
The idea of, for most people, to bringing worms into your home on purpose would sound ridiculous, but you need them.
Yes.
Yeah.
Worm power.
Worm power. So then how did you get from a sustainable agricultural program in Vermont to Jamaica in the Peace Corps? And backing that up, what made you choose the Peace Corps to begin with? Did you know you were doing that while you were in school?
Kind of. It was on the back of my mind. I'm the sort of person who kind of plans out the next step way in advance, or if I don't really know what I'm going to do, I kind of have like the list of 5 things that I could possibly do. And Peace Corps was on that list. Mm-hmm. So
where did you first get interested in Peace Corps?
I guess I was maybe a teenager, and it was when I first started thinking like, I want to do something different, but I don't know what that is.
Yeah.
And Peace Corps was on the back of my mind, but I don't really think I knew what Peace Corps was.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of people really know what Peace Corps is. I was talking about it today with my father when I was back up at home. And I said to him, I said, people kind of forget that the Peace Corps still exists right now. We all think about it as this like late 60s into the 70s sort of hippie movement. And then I went and like looked it up on Wikipedia because I was just like, when did it start? And I remembered vaguely that it was like a Kennedy administration thing when he was like firing on all cylinders and like doing all kinds of youth like get the youths involved in the country type of things right there. But I think a lot of people have forgotten that it exists, or they still kind of hold it in their brains as being that thing of like the 70s. And I'm curious, like, what was your take on it before you joined it? Like, what did you think it was like, even as a teenager? Like, obviously, it seems like this sort of magical service wonderland of travel the world, do some stuff, you know?
Yeah, I think when you first look at it, you think, like, I'm going to go in and save the world.
Yeah.
And, you know, you quickly realize that that's not how things work. Mm-hmm. You know, it's boots on the ground, building
from
nothing.
Based. Yeah. It's local. Yeah.
You're helping people help themselves. And Peace Corps has been in Jamaica pretty much from the beginning, from when Peace Corps started.
Yeah.
So we've been in Jamaica for a long time. A lot of people know what's going on with Peace, or a lot of people surprisingly don't know what Peace Corps still is. You know, it took a while, because I'm the first Peace Corps volunteer in my community.
Mm-hmm.
So it took a while to even explain to non-Americans what Peace Corps is.
To the other people, like...
Yeah, like two community
like
members.
Like one or two towns over who've just... They just haven't gotten there yet, so...
Right, right.
What's the name of the place that you're in Jamaica?
I live in Manchester Parish. It's one of the coolest parishes in Jamaica, so I'm lucky because I can wear a blanket when I go to bed, and many people...
Oh, it's chilly.
Yeah, many people cannot say that. But I kind of live 20 minutes away from Mandeville, which is one of the bigger town centers. So I feel like I kind of have a unique experience because I'm very close to stuff.
Yeah.
Just like you have a different experience in, you know, going to any country,
mm-hmm.
even within the country, you can have a drastically different experience just person to person.
Yeah, yeah, and community to community. So when you get there, like, do they have a plan for you more or less? How long is a stint in the Peace Corps?
It is 27 months.
Okay.
So,
and I know you can re-up at the end of it, or you can apply to re-up or something like that.
Right, you can extend, you know, if you feel like your project still needs, you know, you want to keep going with it or you're loving it, you can extend for a year. You can also do something called Peace Corps Response, which is instead of continuing with your project, if you're still like on a Peace Corps high,
yeah.
you can go, and you can do this at any time, you don't have to do it right after.
Yeah.
You can go do a more of a short-term project anywhere that... is open.
Yeah.
So you may be like super focused on this one thing for 6 months in this country. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah. So what do you, I guess this is a big question. It'll probably take a bit to answer. What's your day to day? What do you do over there?
It's hard to describe.
Yeah.
I mean, I do a lot of things. And sometimes it's still in transition. So what do I do? What I'm working on right now is a couple of things. For one, I work at the primary school, so elementary level students, and I'm helping with the 4-H club. So we're doing a lot of agriculture projects, planting, just trying to get their hands dirty, get them reconnected with nature.
Mm-hmm.
So that's fun. And then there's also a community center in my community that has been closed doors for about 3 years now. So I helped hold a community meeting there and just being like, look at this building. It's a great space. Like,
yeah.
what do you want here? You know, because people have said like, why is it just sit locked up? You know, like,
yeah,
we want to use this space. So people came out and they kind of said their ideas, anything mm-hmm. from, adult training program to a basic school to, like renting it out to make some like money income mm-hmm. for the community. Internet cafe was really popular.
Oh, okay.
So kind of like moving forward with some of their ideas, seeing what we can make happen.
Okay.
And I also work with a women's group called Network of Women, and we are growing mushrooms to alleviate poverty in Jamaica. So we're starting in Manchester. Basically, like, mushrooms are an indoor crop. So
yeah.
Groups of 10 women will come together and say, like, we want a mushroom house, and we'll plop down with the assistance of Food for the Poor, which is an organization we work closely with.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll get their mushroom house started, and they'll grow the mushrooms together, like teamwork, training, all of that. And then we'll take the crop back and then distribute it, so they don't have to worry about that part
okay.
at all. So as you can see, it's kind of, there's a lot of things happening.
Yeah. And fairly different things from each other too. Like one's about use of building space. One's about empowering women and giving them getting them things to do and getting them working together, and also helping the community as well right there. And then you work at the school too. What's a primary school like in Jamaica as opposed to a primary school in the U.S.?
I feel like it's kind of hard to answer that because even in the U.S., the schools can vary so much.
Well, how does it stack up against where you are is fairly rural, I imagine, or a little rural, or is it?
I'd say where I am is, it's pretty populated.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess we all have two images of Jamaica as Westerners. We have the resort image of Jamaica. To me, it's three. I have three images of Jamaica. I have resort Jamaica, which I've never been to Jamaica, but like I have resort Jamaica in my head because that's what everyone thinks of. Everyone went on vacation. You look at their pictures on Facebook. I don't particularly care for that image. Then I have the image of things that I've seen in like Bob Marley and Lee Scratch Perry documentaries where like the kind of the rougher streets and the street crime and things like that, and like cities like Kingston and things, and the rougher side of a country like that. And then in my mind, because I know some of the agricultural things that get grown in Jamaica, I think of the hills and the mountains where they make all the coffee. So,
right. I kind of live kind of in between two like higher population like clusters of people.
Yeah.
So I live up the hill and it's nice and quiet, but you come down and there's three supermarkets, and a hospital and multiple schools. So I have access to pretty much, everything. There's there's stuff happening. But the schools, I would say it's a lot of kids in one classroom.
Yeah.
And that can make it really difficult. I feel like a lot of time is spent just trying to get
order.
Classroom management is definitely a challenge.
How old are these kids that you're working with?
I am working with pretty much first through sixth grade.
And they're all kind of in one room?
For the 4-H club, which is the after-school club. But the whole third grade may be in one room.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard if you have 35 kids in one room. Sometimes even more.
Yeah.
And my school doesn't have this problem, but a lot of schools in Jamaica don't actually have walls separating the classrooms.
Oh, so it's just kind of clusters
right,
of people
right.
And then some space in between them and then
exactly.
Clusters of
like
other
people. Like sometimes there may be like a little like thin board, but it's very difficult.
Yeah, and especially at an age, just all children, regardless of where you come from, like the attention span is all over the place because they're kids and their minds are firing and they see a thing over there and they want to go over there. And
So
when you're doing 4-H, that's got to be a bit of a challenge because you're first through sixth grade. That's like age 7 to age 12, like 11 or 12. So they all have clearly different capabilities when you're 7 versus when you're 12.
It's so true. So we decided to split them up because we tried the whole big group thing happening, and I was thinking like, oh, the older kids can work with the younger kids, but it's
not
better.
So much.
Yeah, at least for now. We'll try that out in the future, but I'm new and I'm still figuring everything out, and I'm still getting used to the school system in general. It's very formal, so I'm Miss Melissa, and good afternoon, Miss Melissa, and I'm not used to the whole structure. So just coming in, just trying to feeling it out. For now, we're going to keep them separate. But I'd like to, have the older ones kind of lead the younger ones and help out in the future.
What's the general climate of having a Peace Corps person in this place that didn't really have one before?
I think a lot of it is just, well, first of all, Peace Corps doesn't send a Peace Corps volunteer anywhere where a community doesn't ask for, or at least, like someone in the community applied for Peace Corps volunteer.
So like maybe a couple of people were involved in the decision of, we should get one of them over here.
Right.
But like the rest of them who were not privy to that decision are probably one who's like, what is this girl doing wandering?
Right.
Wandering the area right now. Where did she come from? Is
she
lost?
Exactly. When I first got there, it was a lot of that. Like, are you lost? Like, or like, whitey. That's not rude.
Yeah.
I get called whitey all the time. So do you know where you're going? Are you on vacation?
Like,
I'm like, no. Like, no, man, I live here.
I'm in the Peace Corps.
Yeah. So
do they by and large know what Peace Corps is, more or less?
It varies. Like you said, I'm new in the community, so a lot of no. And sometimes it's hard to explain, but a lot of people are in communities that, a lot of Peace Corps volunteers are in communities that they followed someone or someone was there a couple of years ago. So it gets easier, and usually if you're working with a school, they definitely know.
Yeah.
Because we've been connecting to schools for such a long time.
What do you find the general, once they find out who you are and what you're there for, are they into it? Are they, they're glad you're there?
Yeah, I think so. Because, I mean, my role is really to help people help themselves. So I say, you know, I'm here, I'm placed in your community. Like, I will, like, give me feedback. Let me know, like, what you'd like to see, and I'll try to make it happen.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's fun. Like, yeah, I'm working in the schools and, like, doing the women's group and help trying to do the whole community center thing. But sometimes I just get to, like, go play football with, you know, the teenage boys. And,
okay.
You know, I may try to, like, rope them in to come do something at the community center after. But there's a lot of, like, it's kind of fun.
Yeah, yeah. It's interesting, too, when you talked about the community center and all the different ideas that the members of the community who came out and had ideas. And it made me think of, I don't know how much you've been, I don't know how much you follow stuff that goes on in Philadelphia while you're, I don't know how much your access is to be able to follow. You seem to be pretty up there on the Facebook and stuff like that.
Yeah, I actually have Wi-Fi. So,
oh, cool.
Sometimes I try to stay posted to an extent.
So what I thought about with the community center thing, when you said, like, oh, we had this meeting and some people wanted to do this and some people wanted to rent it out and things like that. Did you follow the sort of, like, quasi-outrage about Bach Technical High School at, like, 9th and Mifflin over the last, this would have been at the end of the summer? I'll fill you in because this is a really interesting parallel right here. So Bach Technical High School was a vocational high school, huge, like six or seven stories tall, took up most of a city block between like 9th and 10th at Mifflin or Moore. I can't remember, but South Philly. And it closed in the big closings that you were probably really familiar with because it was right in like 2012, 2013, right before you left to go to AmeriCorps. So it sat vacant for like 2 or 3 years. But up to that, before that point, like, it had everything in there. There was an auto shop. There was a culinary school. If you remember Ken from work, he used to take classes there for optometry, where he learned how to, like, grind lenses and things like that.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was a pretty active vocational school, like, in the 70s and 80s, and then fell on the hard times that a lot of schools in Philadelphia fell on. And so during the mass asset sell-off or whatever logic went on in there, it got closed. Giant seven-story building, taking up most of a square city block at 9th and Mifflin. So a developer came in and bought it because that's what the schools wanted. They wanted to sell these things to begin with. They bought it, and while they were figuring out what to do with it, which was, you know, you got seven floors right here. It couldn't just have to be one person's idea. It could be like 12 people's ideas,
right,
all coexisting. They put a beer garden on the top because that's cool right now. That's what the kids are into. And it was beautiful because the view, it was one of the coolest kind of panoramic views from that part of South Philly looking up into Center City, you know, blah, blah. And the people were Instagramming stuff like that. And there was this huge outrage about how they were disrespecting the space and blah, blah, blah. But the idea of rent, when you said the people who came to your community meeting were saying, like, oh, you know, maybe if we rent the place out, and you said internet cafe, and my first thought was, were there going to be people in that community where you are in Jamaica who would find the idea of an internet cafe distasteful? It's a strange roundabout way to get to it, but I'm just, it's an interesting parallel right there where we also in America at times have to kind of sit around and talk about what to do with our disused buildings.
Right. I would say it was more the younger crowd who were like, you know, internet cafe, because they're more in tune with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say a lot of the community probably don't even know how to click a mouse,
yeah,
you know, but they may be interested. So it's kind of figuring out, like, is there an interest in learning how to use a computer, or is it, should the energy be more focused on, like, getting books in the center?
Yeah. No, that's an interesting question to have right there. When you have a space like that, you kind of do have to decide, like, well, it's going to be this thing because it's only a space so big that can only house, you know, so many different things going on at once. But that's really cool. Like, when you said that, it just sparked in my head. I was like, gosh, I wonder what they would do with a space the size of Bach or the size of, as you rode down here, you probably rode down one of the many streets that has a shut down school on it. I know when I ride up to work and back and forth, I pass at least three.
Right.
So, and I'm curious, in Jamaica too, is that a thing where there are, in some of these communities, there are buildings that have just kind of laid empty from disuse? Like maybe at one point somebody used it for something and then...
Yeah, like for example, the community center, I don't think anyone really asked for a community center. I think there's just an organization that's kind of like plopping them around everywhere. Yeah. So there was never really anyone like...
When it was put in originally, it was not like, we're going to use this community center for A, B, C.
Exactly. Yeah. And it was like, we're going to pay for electricity by A, B, C.
It was kind of like, keep up the grounds. We're going to keep up the building. We're going to keep up the plumbing and blah, blah, blah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
There's no long-term or sustainable plan.
Is that a thing that seems that, do you encounter things like that pretty often where it's like somebody clearly a good, it's better intentions to put a community center in somewhere than not, but it's not that simple.
Right. And that's why... With everything that I do, I'm very careful because I'm here for, you know, even though it's 27 months, three of that is training. So you're in your community for 2 years. And I don't want to set something up that's just going to fall apart, you know?
You want something that they want or need or at least express interest towards. Like you wouldn't build, I'm trying to think off the top, you wouldn't build a playground if they didn't want it.
Right. Yeah.
That's really interesting. But it made me think of... Yeah, the best intentions of Western charity sometimes where they're just like, we think about things in our context and we're just like, oh, well, if I was in this place, I would want X, Y, and Z. And then you're just like, these people should have it too. And like, well, yeah, maybe. But sometimes when you go into places with people, it's like, they might need some other stuff that you would take for granted, like much more desperately than they would need, say, a community center, which is not to say a community center wouldn't benefit them.
Yeah, it's so true. I mean, sometimes like as far as schools, like, there may be funding for something, but it's not really what the school needs, you know? So you really do have to be careful that it's something that people, at least when it comes to me, I want to make sure that people want, need, like, desire what's going to happen.
When you're working with the women to make mushroom farms, you want to make sure that, like, this is something that, number one, they want to do, and number two, is feasible and even useful.
Right. And the mushroom project is fun because mushrooms aren't really like widely consumed in Jamaica. So this is kind of like a groundbreaking project. I'm really excited to be a part of it.
What do you guys do with the mushrooms when they grow?
It's still kind of in startup phase. It's been pretty slow. Actually, my supervisor is in Toronto getting a hip surgery right now. So it's kind of at a standstill.
Yeah.
So like, you know, when you ask what a day-to-day basis is like, it's always changing because you never eat like... Even personal relationships could affect my my Peace Corps experience in that way. So right now, it's kind of just, while things are kind of slower, just trying to, I guess, kind of just figure out the structure of what the training's going to look like. Because there aren't any mushroom houses up right now.
Okay.
But it's kind of like, it's going to happen. We have almost all the infrastructure done. We have a building that's going to have the labs, going to have the kitchen processing room. We have a building just to make the compost the mushrooms grow on. So it's slow, but it's definitely moving along.
Yeah. Well, I think that's great. And I wish you the best of luck in making all these mushrooms. Although I'm curious that when you said like, they don't really eat mushrooms, I'm just like, well, that could be a whole other thing after that. It was like, now this is what we do with them.
Right. I think there's a lot of fear of mushrooms, like that you're going to get poisoned. I mean, valid fears.
It's true. Yeah, it has happened.
But there is a lot of button mushrooms being imported for the hotel industry.
Oh, yeah, because that was something I was thinking right there. I said, well, I imagine if you can source your own mushrooms within the country, you could sell those to the resort. Because while Jamaicans might not eat mushrooms, the Westerners who come to the Jamaican resorts on the beach would eat mushrooms.
Right. But I hope, you know, Jamaica learns to love the mushroom because they're
so delicious.
And we
don't give them to the resorts and we keep them. They keep them for themselves. No, that's good. That's great. I mean, we could have a whole conversation about like the many injustices and the ways that like as Western countries, we tend to... I don't want to say victimize, but definitely exploit these countries that, while are incredibly impoverished and not terribly educated by our standards, also have beautiful scenic places to visit. So I know that there's definitely a limit of things you can and can't talk about because being in the Peace Corps, not to put you on the spot at all like that. But.
Right. Oh, and maybe I should verbally post my disclaimer that these are all
my opinions
not of Peace Corps, the U.S. government, or the Jamaican government. So everything said in this podcast is me.
Yes. We'll make sure.
Yeah. Just come in here to Philadelphia.
Yeah.
I flew out of Montego Bay Airport. And
Montego Bay is like a big resort part of Jamaica.
And
one of the bigger.
I've never been up there. I'm not interested in that stuff, obviously, but I've never even like hung out in the general area besides going to the airport. And it's kind of shocking to see all the tourists, first of all. And then, like, it's, you know, I always talk to the person next to me on the plane. So, you know, you find out that they don't leave the resort.
Yeah.
So most of the time, people are scared to leave the resort.
Well, they're typically told not to, from what I've talked to people who've been, like I said, I've never been down there before myself. And for the same reason as you, I don't really have a lot of interest in that kind of vacation experience. I would rather do something more on the level you're doing with, like, go out into the woods, go out into, you know, go see some shit.
Like, hike the Blue Mountains.
Well, yeah, go see some real stuff and not just sit in a pen, which is more or less what it is. It may be a very beautiful, very large pen with, you know, room service and nice drinks and food, but a pen is a pen when you get down to it. But I imagine when you get into the airport at Montego, I mean, number one, especially as you've been in your community, you'd be like, oh, my God. White people.
Yeah, it's really strange. Yeah. And, you know, not only just white people, they have, like, their, like, One Love Jamaica shirt on and, like, all their, like, bracelets and, like, souvenirs. I'm like,
The green, red, and yellow, sort of the Rastafarian colors. And
right, Bob Marley everything.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's a whole other conversation. I mean, that's all the conversation you have right now, which is the takeaways from Jamaica for the rest of the world. Because, I mean, I consider myself to be a fairly educated, cultured, like, open person, but when you say Jamaica, the first thing I think of is ska and reggae, because that's just where my brain goes, and in a super positive way too. Like, some of my favorite artists and stuff have come from Jamaica or have gone through Jamaica and worked. I think Lee Scratch Perry is one of the most brilliant musicians of the West, or not of the West, of our lifetime, and he's a real raconteur and, like, a real kind of rascally character. He's not the safe sort of, like, almost messiah-like image of Bob Marley. He's, you know, dodged the tax man, things like that, did a lot of things the hard way. But that's my takeaway from Jamaica right there. And I know there's some people out there who have even less of a takeaway of Jamaica than that.
No, and I was really into ska music too, and Prince Buster, man, I loved him.
Yeah, and Tommy McCook, Desmond Decker, all that Studio One stuff, and like Lee Scratch Perry and Super Ape and Return of Super Ape and all that dub, because I was into them, because I was into The Clash and stuff growing up and into Rancid, and those guys borrowed heavily from Jamaican music. And rather than stopping there, we were both definitely subjected to the third wave ska movement of the 90s.
Which I also loved.
It is. No, it's great. There's nothing wrong with it. And I'm a big fan of, like, I guess what would be second wave ska of England in the 80s, which was a more direct line to Jamaica and the Caribbean because of the immigrants that would come to London and live in those neighborhoods.
Right, right.
But yeah, I always wanted to find out more. I was like, well, okay, this is where it came from, so I want to hear more and more. And I knew there was more than Bob Marley, and there was.
Yeah, I mean, it is kind of amazing that as small as the country that Jamaica is, that, like, around the world, everybody knows, like, Jamaica, reggae, Bob Marley, ska.
Rastafarianism, too, which is incredibly misunderstood by pretty much everybody.
Yes, yes.
And that's a whole other conversation that one could have. So what's next? Like, so how far into your tour are you right now?
Oh, I'm just a little teenager, I guess. I'm 8 months in out of 2 years.
So you're barely a third of the way through.
Yes, yes.
So I guess it's too early to ask you but you said this before, that you tend to plan out everything pretty well in advance.
Yeah.
So what do you, obviously, who knows what tomorrow or the next day or the next year can bring in what you're doing, but what would you want to be doing when you're done with the Peace Corps?
I feel like when I first finish, I just want to come, and I don't know how, I just want to, like, get a job where I make a lot of money and, like, try to pay off some of my student loans.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But
yeah, the Peace Corps, good for many things, not terribly effective for paying off student loans.
No, no. But
not that they're, and they're not supposed to be. Like, that's not, like, they did nothing wrong.
Yeah.
Right there.
So that aside, Peace Corps actually opens up a lot of opportunities for graduate school. Mm-hmm. There's a fellowships program where they're partnered with a lot of universities, and I'm looking at University of Arizona in Tucson. Maybe doing my master's there. Yeah. I don't know if after Peace Corps I'm going to be like, all right, back to school mode. But that's definitely up there on the list.
And obviously you could keep working the blog while you're over there.
Yeah.
What kind of response do you get from that, from the blog?
It's cool. Actually, recently, a handful of the people who are signed up for Jamaica next year, like the Incoming Peace Corps group, have found my blog because I did the same thing. When I found out I was joining the Peace Corps in Jamaica, I Googled as much as I could, find out as much as I could. And, there's blogs from current volunteers at the time, and I learned a lot from, looking at the experience from a volunteer's perspective. So I've had quite a few people, ask me, like, hey, like, can I email you? Like, I'm a vegan. How's that in Jamaica? What's this like? What's that like? And I'm like, wow. And I even have people from Jamaica, like, saying, like...
Well, I was curious. Do people from Jamaica see your blog as well?
Yeah. And they'll be like, wow, I love Kalu. That's a great recipe. And I'm like, whoa, this is...
I was curious what they thought about not only you being there, but then now you kind of broadcasting your take on it to the rest of the world.
It seems well received. I think excited.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, Jamaicans love to share their culture. The food, the music. I mean, it's all great. So to see someone excited about it is exciting.
No, that's really cool. Maybe you can, one of the pieces of your next 16 months is empower a couple of them to start their own blogs.
That's a good idea. I actually never thought about that. And that would be great for if the computer lessons are wanted and needed. They could learn how to blog. And
yeah, they could start their own podcast.
Yeah, right?
I'll come down.
anytime.
Because apparently only I could possibly.
Are you just trying to come to Jamaica? No.
Yes, but clearly not the resort part. So people will be wondering, like, why are you even doing that?
No, man, you'll be smiling up in the taxi, everything.
I'm not as small as I used to be. No, that's great. Oh. Did you guys want to play or anything like that? Was that a thing that you were thinking of? I don't want to put you on the spot. It was something we tossed back and forth in the email, but it doesn't have.
I don't know. We were practicing a little bit, and I was just like, man, we need more time. George will happily play you a song anytime.
Yeah.
I just probably won't be involved unless I'm just singing in the background. I mean, he is, like, really talented, and I'm like, oh, I'm scared.
Is he up there? George, are you up there?
I am.
Oh, you want to come down?
Sure.
Yeah.
No.
Hold on. What did he say?
Buy my helmet. He will totally play you a song.
So what's the name of this one?
See You in My Dreams.
Cool.
Sings a song of the happiness that used to be. Soon my eyes will close, soon I'll find repose. And in dreams, you're always near to me. I'll see you. Still, I feel the thrill of your charm. tonight. I'll see you in my dreams. Lay your light my lonely way tonight. I'll see you in my dreams.
Much better, right?
Yeah. Who's that originally by?
Oh, that's
old
1920s song.
I don't even know. Like, so many people have covered it.
Yeah.
But it's older.
It's a tale as old as time. Yeah. Awesome. Melissa, thank you so much. George, thanks for coming downstairs.
Sure.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks so much for coming on the show.
One day we'll come back with some insect songs.
Yes. Next time you guys come through America, you don't have to be on the show. We'll just come down here and we'll record all the insect songs.
Yeah, let's do that.
We'll make the insect EP.
Let's do that.
Yes. Thanks so much.
Thanks. We'll be together till the end of time. 25
Well, I hope you really, really enjoyed that. I loved having Melissa here. I loved talking with her. I hadn't seen her in a long time, too, so it was kind of great just as an excuse to just sit down and talk to someone that you haven't seen in a long time. Like I said before at the top of the show, you can follow Melissa's adventures here and abroad at her blog, mxdrum.wordpress.com. That's the letter M, the letter X, drum.wordpress.com. And like I said before, I'm going to put that up at 25oclockpod.com on the Friends and Neighbors page, where you can view information about Melissa and all the other guests that have ever graced the table here at 25 o'clock, wherever that table may be. Hey, by the way, welcome to episode 30. I mean, you're leaving episode 30 now. I didn't think to talk about it at the top of the episode, but I'm going to talk about it now. It's episode 30. I actually remembered to talk about a number of some importance here on the show. So, hey, thanks to all of you who've been with me for 30 episodes. And, hey, thanks to all of you who this is maybe your first or second episode that you're ever hearing 25 o'clock. It's great. There are 29 previous episodes to this. Should you want to hear them, they're all available at 25oclockpod.com, as I shamelessly plug constantly here on the show. Anyway, I hope you all have a good holiday. I hope you travel well. I hope you visit well. I hope you eat well. I hope you be well. I hope you are well. I hope you be well. You know what I'm getting at here. I'm trying to express nice sentiments to people, and if my English isn't exactly accurate when I do that, then, you know, I hope you overlook the format of the message and just accept the fact that I'm wishing you well this Thanksgiving season. We're going to go out on a track from an artist. I know I haven't done that in a while, but this was sent to me, like, in the mail, like, handwritten on an envelope. From a folk musician named Dann Pell. He resides in Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, which is just north of Philadelphia. The record is called Rose Blues, and I'm going to play a song of the same name. So this is a song called Rose Blues from the album Rose Blues by Dann Pell. Here on 25 o'clock, I'm your host, Dan Drago. Take care of yourselves. I'll catch you next time.
The meaning isn't lost in the wind. we find ourselves in. Come closer to the horizon. Let out your lonesome cry. It's not all of life to live, and it's not all of death to die. It's a soft sigh, slightly turning, gently beside me comes a prayer of yearning. There's a garland of roses, here in the sun. A prayer of yearning. There's a God.